Among fundamental independent Baptists, we have some that say, oh, don't say that anymore because now it conjures up ideas of the Taliban or some other kind of thing. What is fundamental? What does it mean to be fundamental? What are we fundamental in? In your hairstyle that gets you cut, your sideburns are exactly a certain length, or your, the ladies have to make up a certain way. Is that what makes you a fundamentalist? No way. Absolutely not. We're fundamental when it comes to the Bible, when it comes to the teaching, when it comes to adhering to, believing 100% in the Word of God. The fundamentals of the faith are what we're talking about. And so there can only be fundamentalism when there is sound doctrine. Sound doctrine. We live in a sin-sick world, spiritually speaking. And the world doesn't need a few more, good stories and some folks that can get behind the pulpit and just entertain. There's nothing wrong with having a good time. We're all for that. But this world is starving to death.
Amen.
For sound doctrine. And the research is it. We have found that in fact is the case. Even when a person doesn't know what they're looking for, they find it when they land somewhere where the Word of God is being preached and teached and the sound doctrine is in place. So important. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 6 says, if thou put the brethren in remembrance of these things, thou shalt be a good minister of Jesus Christ, nourished up in the words of faith and of good doctrine, whereunto thou hast attained. Hey, we're all about preaching and teaching this book. No doubt about it. You know, there's an attitude today that you can't get anything done unless you compromise. Isn't that what we're always told is the problem in government today, that there isn't enough compromise? May I tell you, the truth is there's too much compromise. There's way too much compromise. And if you don't have any sound beliefs, if you don't really believe anything, you know, and I know I've said it, I think he just said it recently, that the church that doesn't stand for anything will fall for anything. There's no doubt about that. And so this whole business of compromise, I think you need to be concerned about it. Kind of reminds me of the hunter who saw a bear, and the bear said, hey, listen, Mr. Hunter, let's compromise. Now, here's what I want to explain to you. I want a full stomach, and what would you like to have? And the hunter said, well, I'd like to have a fur coat. Well, you know what? They both got their way. He got a full stomach, the bear did, and guess what? The hunter had a full coat. Amen? Hey, compromise will kill you. Compromise will destroy any stance that you might have. Titus chapter 1, verse 9. Holding fast the faithful word as he hath been taught, that he may be able by sound doctrine both to exhort and to convince the gainsayers. Philippians chapter 2, verse 15. That ye may be blameless and harmless, the sons of God, without rebuke, in the midst of a crooked and perverse nation, among whom ye shine as lights in the world. Does that sound like a verse that ought to speak to the headlines of the day?
Yep.
Holding forth the word of life, that I may rejoice in the day of Christ, that I have not run in vain, neither labored in vain.
Amen.
You see, the modern church is lacking in its ability to remain uncontaminated by the unchristian thinking and morality of contemporary culture.
That's right.
It breaks my heart to say we're not doing a good job in this area. We, it has been said, and I'm even willing to admit this right in front of everybody, the Lord and everybody, yes, I am from California. I was born and raised in California. Can I tell you something that you don't know about California? California is not Los Angeles. California is not San Francisco. As a matter of fact, if you were to pluck Los Angeles and San Francisco out of California, it would become a red state. It would become a more conservative state. I came from a little bitty town out in the middle of the desert, Blythe, California. Anybody ever been there? That's a good place to be from, amen? That's a good place to be from, because if you get stuck there and it's 118 degrees, you're thinking, oh my, let's preach on hell. I'm telling you, we knew what hot was about. By the way, when we brought everybody back from the Indian reservation, that nobody has complained about the heat since we got back. I don't know what that's all about. No problems anymore. May I tell you that they used to say this, and they probably still do. You take all of the problems that kind of come out of Hollywood, and so California gets labeled because that's Hollywood, and all you got to do is just kind of go across America, and basically it seems like all of the things that they're doing in Hollywood will jump across the mid-states, and it'll all be happening also on the East Coast. The West Coast and the East Coast are the most sinful parts of the world, of America, for sure. I'm just going to tell you that. But what begins to gradually happen, those things that have become, odd and unusual and unacceptable on the coast begin to start permeating into the rest of the country. And before you know it, middle America is only a few years behind the coast. How many would agree with that? Have you seen that happen? I've watched that happen over and over again. But may I say this? That's happening in the church. Rather than sound doctrine changing culture, culture is changing the church. And we are supposed to be the ones that take the stand and say, we're not going to let that happen. Now, whenever you say something like that from a pulpit, somebody is going to accuse you of being mean-spirited and narrow and rigid and a nonconformist. I say, no, I just want to please the Lord. I just want to do what He wants us to do. And quit looking at the rest of the world, quit looking at what's on MSNBC. Oh my, if that's on your TV, get rid of your TV, amen. If you're looking at the rest of the world and saying, we need to be more like what they do in order to reach them, we've already lost the battle. That's the mistake that was made back in the 70s, and it hasn't changed. It's gotten worse. The seeker-sensitive mentality that says, look like, walk like, talk like, sing like, act like the world, and the world will come flowing into your church. Well, that'll happen, but it won't be church. It won't be church.
That's right.
Secondly, there needs to be a culture of training. A culture of training. Notice again, Titus chapter 2, notice with me verse 2 and 3. That the aged men, that would be people of Will Ashley's age, and older. And yes, the pastor. That the aged men be sober, grave, temperate, sound in faith, in charity. How about this one, men? Are you ready? In patience. Somebody give an amen.
Amen.
How about an
oh my?
Notice verse 3. The aged women likewise. Now, can I just tell you what I will not do? This is important that you get this. I will not tell you how old an aged woman is. Not going to happen. We will not mention how old you are when you become an aged woman. That the aged woman likewise, that they be in behavior as becometh holiness. Not false accusers, not given to much wine, teachers of good things. Oh my. How about we just revisit the Word of God every once in a while? And, doesn't this just fly in the face of all of our lame excuses? This is who we're supposed to be. We are being described right there. And you want to know how you get that done? Training.
Yep.
When Pastor Will Ashley was telling TJ, have your hand right, feel that baton, and squeeze when you feel the slap of the baton, he was being trained. He was being taught to run the race. That's our job. Can I tell you, I am one who is proud to say that I am a fundamental independent Baptist preacher.
Amen.
I am very proud to say that. And I'm thankful for what God has done over the years in challenging men and women to have an emphasis on soul winning and get out there and get the job done. We're all real tired of watered down, middle of the road stuff. I mean, I am. I don't like it, and neither do you. But I'll tell you, and I can say this because I've, been in ministry for long enough years that if you don't like it, that's just the way it goes. I'll say this. Where we miss the boat in many of our own churches is we've almost kind of, in a tongue-in-cheek way, laughed at teaching.
Oh, no, I don't teach. I preach. I preach, and I'm going to preach it.
You know what? Preaching and teaching cannot be separated.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. We, Brother Lily over and his wife and their family have been teaching men and women of God to go out and do the work that God has called them to do. We don't think that you can separate teaching from preaching. And we as a local body of believers in this local church will champion teaching.
That's right.
That's why 3 years ago we started the Bible Institute. We're believing that it's the requirement of the church that the church train. Amen?
Amen.
And we will next semester this fall, we will start we will begin to finish the third year for many of our third year students. That means they have committed to 3 years of being faithful to the Bible Institute.
Amen.
To doing the studies and serious Bible training, and you know what? It's already paying off. We're already seeing God use this this emphasis on teaching in a wonderful way. We're to train, folks. We need to have a culture of training. The church's effectiveness is enhanced or limited only by the spirituality of its people. And you are not going to be where you need to be spiritually if you don't know this book, if you don't know the Word of God, if you're not growing in this book. I loved the conversation I had with someone yesterday. This person said he was struggling spiritually, and he was advised that, you know what, you spend time in Romans chapter 6, 7, and 8, and don't leave until you're better. That will fix you more than anything will. Get into the Word of God, study the Word of God, and God will do big things. You know what? Society is not the answer. Society has more problems today than it's ever had. You know, Brother Heim, you can walk into a prison right now and talk to guys that are doing serious time, and you can ask them guys, because I did it myself. I did this 15 years ago. I remember walking into prison and asking these guys, hey, do you think things are worse now than they were 15 years before or not? And these guys are in prison.
Yep.
And you want to know what they told me? Things are worse.
Yes.
Things are worse now. So that's now 30 years ago. May I tell you, folks, society is sick. And the more we see what's going on today, all you got to do is turn on the television. All you got to do is just listen to what's going on around you, and you can see it.
That's right.
You know, a few years ago, I bought a book by H.B. London. Some of you might even own this book, The Heart of a Great Pastor. It's a very good book. It's on my shelf. And if I loan it to you, I will break your arm if you don't give it back. Just want you to know we live in the right spirit. That's how we do things around here. The Heart of a Great Pastor. By the way, forget all the stuff that you loaned me. Okay? It's mine now. Let's admit that no one knows how to deal with the moral decay and spiritual disintegration that is sweeping our nation and world. A serious sickness of the soul seems to be crippling individuals, families, churches, and communities. Counterfeit ministries have nauseated the masses. Judeo-Christian values are being discarded without trial. Something must be done. Civilization stands at a moral abyss. Newscasters sounding like Old Testament holy men using the latest technology predict that doomsday is just around the corner. Without intending to be religious, the media reminds us constantly that we are being destroyed, like the Roman Empire from within. Chastity and character have fallen to a low point, rooted in a permissive revolution